Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we will be discussing the basics of the bones, or the osteology of the upper limb. Much to do here, so let's get started. We will start with our old friend the clavicle, or colloquially referred to as the collarbone. This bone is kind of a strut between the thorax, this region, and the upper limb region, and is palpable for most individuals throughout its length. There is a sternal or medial end, which I typically describe as being more bulbous. It looks a little bit more circular, and as its name would suggest, it's going to articulate with the sternum. And it also has an acromial or lateral end, which appears more flattened in comparison to the medial end. And this is going to articulate with the acromion of the scapula. We will be spending quite a bit of time on the scapula in upcoming sessions, but for now, just a reminder of location of this bone. This bone is often referred to as the shoulder blade and can be seen from an anterior view in terms of these projections right here and the glenoid fossa. But it's really most prominent when you're looking at a posterior view where you can really see the body and size of the scapula. So certainly more to come in upcoming sessions regarding the scapula. The humerus articulates with the scapula at the head of the humerus, which is the ball, and the ball and socket joint that is the shoulder joint. Here's the socket right here of the scapula. The head always points medially when you're trying to get oriented, so it's heading towards or in the direction of the thorax. Looking at the distal end of the humerus, it widens again, and that makes sense as it will be forming joints again. And in this case, we're talking about the elbow region when we're talking about the distal humerus. Anytime that you have a smooth area on bone, this is a good indication that that portion of bone plays a role in joint formation. There would be articular cartilage there during life. The trochlea, which I'm outlining right here, it's kind of spool-shaped, is more medially placed, and will articulate with the ulna to form the humero-ulnar joint, which is the true elbow joint. I think the trochlea is pretty distinguishable from the more bulbous capitulum over here, which is just lateral to it. But if I'm still confused and I'm trying to get my bearings, I look to see which one is next to the more distinct projection, just superior to it. Which right here, this is the medial epicondyle. We'll talk more about that in terms of it being attachment site for forearm muscles. But the articular surface that's closest to the medial epicondyle will be the trochlea. Now, if you flip the humerus to see a posterior view, so this is an anterior view, this is a posterior view. And I know that because you see this prominent depression right here, called the olecranon fossa. And this is where the olecranon of the ulna, or the point of the elbow, so if you're feeling the back of your elbow region, that bone right there, if it's in the olecranon fossa during full extension of the elbow joint, so you do need a depression on the humerus in order to be able to receive that portion of the bone. Moving to the bones of the forearm, of which there are two, the ulna is the medial forearm bone, and it's significantly larger or more complex proximally, so this is proximal or superior, and tapers to much smaller as you move distally. And this has everything to do with the fact that the ulna plays a dominant role in the elbow joint and little and no articulating role in the wrist joint. There are two dominant structures on the proximal portion of this bone. On the posterior surface of the ulna, so this is a straight anterior view here, so you can't see it very well, but you can see over here, this posterior surface right here is the olecranon. And again, this is a robust region. It's the point of the elbow, so easily palpated on the posterior portion of the elbow. It's built up because that triceps brachii muscle is going to attach there. More anteriorly placed, there is this semilunar notch right here, and you can see it right here as well. This is called the trochlear notch. And this is going to articulate with the trochlea of the humerus that we saw in the previous slide. The radius is the more lateral forearm bone, and it has kind of an opposite pattern from the ulna. It's going to be smaller proximally as it plays a smaller role in the elbow region and widens as you move distally because it plays an important role in the radiocarpal or wrist joint. And let's discuss structures on the ends of these bones. The head is this button-shaped circular region at the very proximal most portion of the radius. And this is going to articulate with both the capitulum of the humerus that we saw on the distal end of the humerus, as well as the radial notch of the ulna. So it's going to form two separate joints there. On this distal most end, in fact, you have to kind of flip the bone over to really see. You see this area right here called the carpal articular surface. This is really nice and smooth, indicating that there was hyaline cartilage there during life and plays a big role in terms of joint formation, specifically in terms of the wrist joint. Now we have finally reached the wrist and hand, so we will start proximally and move distally. Shaded in green here, you have the carpal bones, which are often referred to as wrist bones, of which there are eight, and you're going to have two separate rows. You'll have your proximal row and your distal row of carpal bones. Shaded in orange are the metacarpals, and these are located in the palm region and are numbered 1 to 5 from lateral to medial. So this stout bone right here is the lateral most, and it is the one associated with the thumbs. And so the bones associated with the thumb are going to be numbered 1, and they're the lateral most. So the first digit in the hand is lateral, which is the opposite of what occurs in the foot, with the first digit being medial. I always remember first digit in hand is associated with the thumb, first digit in the foot is associated with the big or great toe, and then I can kind of count from there. So this would be the first metacarpal, second, third, fourth, and the fifth will be the medial most in terms of the metacarpals. There are three types of phalanges named based on relative location. Shaded in pink are the proximal phalanges, which are numbered in the same scheme as the metacarpals. In light purple, you will have the middle or intermediate phalanges. Notice that there is not an intermediate phalange or middle phalange in the first digit. That's why there are 14 phalanges, not 15. And lastly, in light blue, you will have the distal phalanges, which are quite distinctive in shape. You have this interesting shape like that. Excellent. That was the basic introduction to the bones of the upper limb. Please take time to look at this image that gives a complete picture of the bone so you can see the relationship with other bones and you can appreciate things a bit more. Notice how much longer the humerus is than the other bones. Notice that the ulna is medial and the radius is lateral. Things like that. Kind of just use this to kind of take in everything that you just learned in the previous slides. I thank you for your time and attention here, and I always feel free to reach out to me or any of my anatomy colleagues with questions. Have a great rest of your day.